You are about to witness the very exciting story of a city and its people. It will be an adventure that will open new sights in familiar surroundings. It is a story of a city seeking new horizons in a resolute contest with great challenges. That city is Detroit, home of nearly 2 million people. Back in 1701, long before this land became a nation, Cadillac planted the colors of France on Detroit's shore. And thus began a rich and inspiring history which has brought Detroit to its finest hour, the today of which we are a part. Yes, Detroit is enjoying its finest hour. There is a renaissance, a rebirth in the city. There's a newness in Detroit.
Question for you. What does this city know about luxury? Huh? What does a town that's been to hell and back know about the finer things in life? Well, I'll tell you. More than most. You see, it's the hottest fires that make the hardest steel. Add hard work and conviction, and the know-how that runs generations deep in every last one of us. That's who we are. That's our story. Now, it's probably not the one you've been reading in papers, the one being written by folks who've never even been here and don't know what we're capable of. Because when it comes to luxury, it's as much about where it's from as who it's for. Now, we're from America, but this isn't New York City, or the Windy City, or Sin City, and we're certainly no one's Emerald City.
Motor City. And this is what we do.
Thank you all very much, although that might have been for Eminem, I don't know. We will still accept all the applause. Of course, applause is for my guest, David Marinus, 12-time author of books, of course, 2-time Pulitzer Prize winner. That is no small trick, to say the least. The video you just saw, though, I'm going to jump ahead here, I'm going to jump back later on, but it got you. It got me. It also got David Marinus when it came out in 2011 during the Super Bowl. Please tell us the story of how that sparked this book, Once in a Great Story. Oh, sorry, Once in a Great City. That'll screw up your sales. Sorry. Once in a Great City, a Detroit story by David Marinus.
This book came to me in the oddest ways. I have to be obsessed to write a book because I spend 3 to 4 years on it and just takes over my life, as my wife will attest. And this one came to me. I was in New York City at a bar watching the Super Bowl in 2011. It was kind of a surreal experience because the Packers, and whenever I'm in Michigan, I have to first confess I'm a Packer fan. Sorry.
Don't worry. There are no Lions fans here.
They're my second team. Anyway, my book on Vince Lombardi, When Pride Still Mattered, had been turned into a Broadway play, which was just a great experience for me. And my wife and I moved to New York City and I probably watched it 37 times, but the Packers happened to be playing in the Super Bowl the year the play was on Broadway. So I was in a bar in Midtown Manhattan with the cast of the play. Dan Loria, who played Vince Lombardi on Broadway, was standing next to me, and we were watching the game, and then at halftime, a sort of surreal experience, the network broadcast a little skit about Vince Lombardi, because with the Packers, you have to talk about him, and there was Dan on the screen and standing next to me. And then after that skit was over, I looked up at the screen again and saw a freeway sign that said Detroit. And then all of those iconic images that you saw from that commercial flashed by on the screen, the Joe Louis fist, the Spirit of Detroit sculpture, the great Diego Rivera murals at the Detroit Institute of Arts, and then Eminem, who I'm too old to be an Eminem guy, or I was, but I sort of am now after this, in that black sedan and getting out and walking into the great, glorious Fox Theater and the black gospel choir rising in song. And by the end of that commercial, I had tears in my eyes. Why? I was born in Detroit. And my wife is in the audience, so she always yells at me for telling this part of the story wrong. But basically, when I told her this, she said, well, why are you falling for that? They're just selling Chryslers. You don't want to buy a Chrysler. And Detroit's a mess. All of which was true, but my emotional reaction to that single commercial was much deeper than trying to sell a car. My primordial memories are in Detroit. They're of Werner's ginger ale, you know, so powerful it would clean out my nostrils. Of the Boblo boat, of Hudson's department store where my mother worked during the Christmas season. One traumatic memory of we lived on Dexter about a mile up from Grand River. And when I was 5 and 6, my mom would put me on a bus and I'd go down to the Fisher Y. And
by yourself.
By myself. That was fine. But going into a freezing pool naked, swimming with other little boys to learn how to swim was kind of traumatic. But that was another one of my earliest experiences. So all of that washed over me from this commercial. And I started thinking about why it hit me that way, what Detroit meant to me, what I could do about it. And I thought, well, I'm a writer, I should write. So much about what Detroit gave to me, but something larger, what it gave America, which is an enormous amount. And that's what I wanted to capture in this book. Two things, both the many great things about America that began or were tested in Detroit, and then the early signs of its sad decomposition over several decades after that.
Well said. By the way, the video was his idea, and your daughter, I believe, helped you with that.
Yeah, well, you know, after my last book, my daughter, who's an actress and her friend who does videos, my daughter said, Dad, you're so old school. People want to see things now, you know? So she made these videos. We're only going to show a couple tonight, but yes, she helped with
Pretty
this.
Cool. Your background, you mentioned, of course, Detroit. Born and raised here until age 6 and a half or so.
Right.
A lot of time in Madison, where your dad was the editor-in-chief.
My dad was a newspaper man. My mother was a scholar. I'm the dumb kid in my family. My siblings were, well, one was a classical pianist and two were professors. And I followed my dad into the ink-stained wretch profession.
Well, here's to it, of course. Among his books, and I urge you not only to buy, of course, the current book, Once in a Great City, but I'm a huge David Maris fan long before I met him, long before he became a mentor of mine along the way. But a few you have to read. One is First in His Class about Bill Clinton, published in 1994 when in his second year as president, of course. That also won the Pulitzer Prize, I believe.
Well, the stories that led to that did,
there we
not
go.
The book itself.
So the answer is yes, it did, okay? So Details. Of course, written about Obama as well, President Obama. On the political side, a few other political books. On the sports side, written about Roberto Clemente, as Ann Stanton pointed out earlier. It's a fantastic book about a Puerto Rican baseball player, of course, Hall of Famer. Rome, 1960, about the Olympics in Rome, featuring a young boxer named Cassius Clay,
right,
also known as Muhammad Ali. One of the killer scenes in there, of course, is when Wilma Rudolph, whom he is hitting on throughout the book, she says, get away, fool. So there you have it.
He was 18, and he had all of the attributes of Muhammad Ali would later, except he was just kind of, he didn't have any of the political weight to him yet. So the other athletes in Rome considered him kind of a little bit immature and foolish, yes.
Hard to believe, but anyway. Lombardi, of course, When Pride Still Mattered about Vince Lombardi. I'm telling you right now, this is one of the best biographies about anyone anytime, forget sports. It's not about that. It's about getting in the side of a soul of a man who was incredibly driven to do what he did. I was impressed by the fact that of all the books they could have listed on here, along with this one, of course, it says, author of When Pride Still Mattered. How did you pick that book?
I didn't. And you might be impressed, but it's pure crass commercialism. The Lombardi book sold like 10 times more than any of my other books, which sold well, but Lombardi was the biggest hit, so they just figure they'll promote, try to make this one look like that.
Well, that's how, then, isn't it?
I would have chosen another book, but
what would you have chosen?
Well, probably the Vietnam book. It has the most similarities in its structure mm-hmm. to this one, a sociological study of a specific period of time.
That's Madison, Wisconsin in the 1960s. They walked into daylight.
Close. They marched into sunlight. Two things that I'm used to. One is people saying Moranis instead of Marinus.
I got that one.
And the
right.
other is they walked into daylight, yes.
There we go.
So that's just as good. But
two very embarrassing parts of that. One, I did actually read the book. It's on my shelves. Two, it's written down correctly here. So that's why I'm usually in that seat and not in this seat. We know what I'm doing here. My impression of these books, despite the incredible range, you tend to focus on ambitious, proud, and clever underdogs who figure out a way to beat the odds. And you're always more interested in these guys on the way up than on the way down. In some ways, that is this Detroit story, because Detroit, you've captured this for 18 months, from 1962 to 1964. And Detroit, I mean, I knew how good it was, and I read the stories, and I knew the Life magazine article. We talked about that before. Mm-hmm. The Olympic bid we'll get to shortly. They bid for the 1968 Olympics and almost got them. But I had no full appreciation of how glorious Detroit was at its heyday until I read this book, and not just, of course, automotive, but obviously music, politically ahead of the curve, no question, socially, mm-hmm. you name it. The Bacon theory of history, if you'll indulge me on this one, I was taught, like too often, too many people were, the big old glacier comes in, it changes everything, nothing you can do about it, the glacier goes out, and the world's different. I reject this. I believe firmly that individuals matter, and moments matter, and they can change history. A TED talk I gave on Branch Rickey and, of course, Jackie Robinson, a conversation in 2015 Montague Street in Brooklyn, when he pulls him up to the Brooklyn Dodgers 2 years later, that changes history based on those two men. Mm-hmm. This book is chock full of individuals and moments that clearly changed history. Detroit's success was hardly inevitable, and nor was its demise. And seeing it teed up this way was exhilarating to read, to say the least. The individuals include a short list. Henry Ford II, also known as Hank the Deuce, far more complicated than I ever realized. Walter P. Reuther, the UAW leader, of course, a very brave soul, to say the least, with great vision. Berry Gordy Jr., of course, you know him as the founder of Motown. His story is amazing, occasionally hilarious. We'll get to that. Mayor Jerome Kavanaugh of Detroit and Police Commissioner George Edwards. I had always undersold those two in this equation. They were fighting the good fight. They sadly lost it, frankly, on a grand scale, as well as many others. But those are just a few of the big names walking through this book. I guarantee you, in every single case, they are not what you thought they were. The research is deep, compelling. And I recall talking to you about this years ago, about how you write about difficult characters. And you told me a great bit of advice. He said, you can always be sympathetic. In other words, whether or not you agree with the guy's position or not, or what he ended up doing with his chances in life, you can always try to see it from his point of view, be empathetic, and try to understand what the world will look like from his viewpoint. And that's exactly what you've done again and again and again with an incredibly wide range of characters. Pick any of those you like. And
should I just leave now?
It won't get better.
Thank you for all of that. Let me start by saying that for a book like this, and for many of the stories I do, I use the metaphor of setting up an oil rig somewhere and digging down as deeply as I can. Rather than going wide and superficial, I try to find the universal in a particular moment and in particular people. So with the Detroit story, what I wanted to do was evoke what it gave America, which, as you articulated, was the UAW as the heart of the American labor movement under Reuther, the automobile, and I use Ford and Henry Ford II to tell that story, and the creation of sort of the car of the 1960s, the Mustang. And music through Berry Gordy and Motown. My question there was, why did this creative burst of energy come out of Detroit at that time and place with the marvelous musicians? And then the final one was civil rights. Now, I started the book thinking about those four major threads, but I didn't really know how I was going to tell that story, except for I knew that I wanted to dig deep. And that took me to a specific period of time. The book starts in October of 1962, and that allows me the opportunity to introduce onto the stage both the automobile through the Detroit Auto Show, which, for those of you from Detroit, know was kind of like the Academy Awards of the Midwest, a huge deal down at Cobo Hall. And also that very same week, the two busloads of young musicians were leaving Grand River to take the first Motortown Review to the nation. This bus, including the most incredible group of talent, I'm a post-war baby boomer, and Motown was sort of the music of my generation, along with the Beatles and so on, but I loved Motown. And that bus had on it little Stevie Wonder, age 12, who drove everybody else crazy because he allegedly didn't know whether it was day or night on the bus. So he'd be singing and playing his harmonica at 3 a.m. Marvin Gaye, you know, this fabulous crooner, soulful and sexy. Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, one of the geniuses of modern music. The Temptations, Martha and the Vandellas, Mary Wells, and oh, by the way, this group that was the opening act and nobody knew if they'd make it or not, called the Supremes. So anyway, that's why I wanted to start the book with ushering those two onto the stage. And then where do I end it? Well, I realized that I wanted something that would be sort of wistful, that would leave people knowing what was to come and the downfall of Detroit and so many hopes and dreams in different ways. But of course, the figures in the book don't know that. And so it ends with President Johnson coming to Detroit in the spring of 1964, declaring the city the herald of hope for America, and then going to Ann Arbor and giving the Great Society address. And that's sort of in between that. Everything happens. The grist of the book, both those four major threads showing themselves in marvelous ways, and you also will see some of the seeds of Detroit's destruction.
That's also incredible. You can see the seeds as high as it was at that time. The seeds are there, and you point them out. I've got to point out myself the Great Society speech that you mentioned, May 22nd of 1964.
This is great.
At the Big House in Ann Arbor, U of M Stadium. I was there in my mother's womb, actually. So
I would have interviewed him, but he couldn't remember anything.
Hopeless interview right there. Didn't know a thing, actually. So there you go. The seats, the big moments. The Rotunda, by the way, the Detroit Rotunda.
Sure.
Some of you might recall this. I thought I knew Detroit architecture fairly well. I've written a fair amount about Albert Kahn, who built a good chunk of modern Detroit. A list includes of Albert Kahn's building in Detroit. The Fisher Building, the GM World Headquarters, Belle Isle Casino, Detroit Police Headquarters, the Detroit News, the Detroit Free Press, the Detroit Athletic Club, the Detroit Golf Club, the Grosse Pointe Country Club, the list goes on and on. If you're a U of M fan, University of Michigan fan, he basically built the modern campus, which includes Burton Tower, Angel Hall, West Engineering, Natural Sciences Building, Graduate Library, the Old Hospital, not to mention the Ann Arbor News Building, and the Delta Gamma Sorority. So this guy got around in Ann Arbor, clearly.
Everything in my book was built by Albert Kahn, basically. At one point, I just say, built by who else?
Exactly. Albert
Kahn.
You gave up at that point,
right.
Uncle. It's amazing how often he was kind of a quiet force in this. The Rotunda, I knew nothing about. This is one of the top five, you tell us, top five tourist attractions
in the United States
at the time. So please fill us in about the Rotunda.
You know, I didn't know anything about it either. It sort of fell into my story accidentally. I was studying something else, and I saw all these stories about a fire dominating the front page when I was looking for something else. And then I realized, hey, this is very symbolic of what I want to write about in the book. But I knew about the Ford Rotunda as a five-year-old, and even later, when we'd be driving from Detroit to Ann Arbor, where my grandmother lived, we'd pass this amazing spherical building. And it burned down on November 9th, 1962, right when my book is starting. It was, according to all of the research I did, the fifth most popular tourist destination in America for a while. It was designed by Albert Kahn in Chicago for the 1939 exposition, and then moved piece by piece back to Dearborn, where Ford Motor Company used it as their showroom, where they started tours that would go to the Great River Rouge plant.
Mm-hmm.
Built by Albert Kahn,
thank
of course.
You.
but what allowed me to tell that story in a more personal way was I found a guy who, when I found him, he was a retired police officer with a PhD from Wayne State University. But as a 13, 14-year-old, he was a juvenile delinquent who would skip school and go hang out at the Ford Rotunda. And he was also, he told me, an arsonist. He loved to burn garages. So when the Ford Rotunda burned...
Are you listening?
When the Ford Rotunda burned, all of his ne'er-do-well buddies thought that he had burned it down. And he sort of lived off that reputation for a while. But anyway, the symbolism is obvious. It was sort of the representative building of the great auto industry at the time. And it burned down on the very same day that the symbol of African-American Detroit, the Gotham Hotel, a hotel where virtually every famous African-American in American history slept there, from Louis Armstrong to all of the great women singers, Sarah Vaughan, Billie Holiday, to Martin Luther King. And it was raided on the same day that the Rotunda burned down, and raided by the feds and the local police because it was the center of the numbers racket in Detroit. And they raided it in a very violent way with axes and tore down everything. And really, it was the destruction of a part of African-American life in Detroit happening at the same time.
You can see right there the seeds, the beginning of the end is there.
Well, the reason that I focused on that part of it, the Gotham Hotel, is that in the late 1950s and early 60s, Detroit was undergoing massive urban renewal, which the blacks in Detroit called Negro removal. There was almost a complete disregard for their traditional community, and a perhaps well-intentioned but misguided belief among urban planners that you could just wipe out these neighborhoods and put in freeways or maybe some high-rise tenement houses, and that would be new and better. But it was the complete destruction of Paradise Valley and Black Bottom in Detroit, and it created ripple effects all the way through the city. One of the people I interviewed for that part of the book was a Reverend Nicholas Hood, who was 90 years old when I talked to him. And he recalled sitting in his church when the urban planners came to visit him and tell him that, you know, he would have to leave. And they showed him a plan of that whole neighborhood, and the black churches were not in the map. It was that kind of disregard that was going on at that time.
You make it very clear in the book, too, how essential the black churches were to the culture, including, by the way, Motown.
Oh, very much so, yes. Most of the, you know, one of the, to get to Motown, I was trying to figure out why it happened in Detroit, and one of the elements is the great migration of African Americans from the South, bringing with them the church music and oral traditions. Not just Motown. I mean, the most famous preacher in Detroit then was Reverend C.L. Franklin. You might think about the last name for a second, and who his daughter was, Aretha. And Reverend C.L. Franklin is another major figure in my book, one of the more colorful ones. He was such a popular preacher that he, during the 1950s, would fly around to cities in the South, fill up arenas, 10,000 people, like it was Bruce Springsteen or something, And everybody knew his sermons. So they would call out for their favorite sermon to be preached, just like they were calling out for their favorite song at a rock concert. You know, tell us the eagle stirreth its nest. And he would do it, and then his fabulous three daughters, including Aretha, would sing. So he was very, very popular, kind of a street preacher on Hastings Street in the old part of Black Detroit. During summer, so many people would come to his church to listen to him that they had loudspeakers outside, and hundreds of people would be listening outside. He was also sort of like Hank the Deuce, colorful, evocative in other ways. So the other black preachers in town didn't necessarily respect him or like him, or were a little envious of him in some ways. But I found him to be very important in that period, not just for representing Black Detroit, but also because of his relationship with Martin Luther King and the Civil Rights Movement.
Speaking of that, by the way, two famous speeches that I know you know were first delivered in Detroit before they became
That's
worldwide
famous.
That's
absolutely right.
Including I Have a Dream, Martin Luther King delivered that in Detroit before Lincoln Memorial. And of course, ask not what you can do, what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. JFK tried that one out in Detroit as well.
That's pretty good.
Thank you. I'm getting slowly better as we go along. So.
No, I mean the Kennedy impersonation.
Oh, thank you.
Well, to start with Kennedy, as many of you know, when a Democratic candidate for president would launch their campaign back in the day when there weren't permanent campaigns, they would start in Detroit, in Cadillac Square, on Labor Day. That was the tradition. And so Kennedy was there on Labor Day in 1960 with Walter Reuther, the president of the United Auto Workers, at his side. And it was in that speech that he used the first formulation of ask not what your country can do for you. Ted Sorensen, his speechwriter, inverted it later to give the ask not at the beginning of the of the sentence, but it was basically the same thing. Probably the most famous inaugural phrase of the 20th century, I would argue.
I would say.
One of them. And as for Martin Luther King, it was Reverend Franklin who invited him to Detroit. The spring and summer of 1963 was really the heart of the 60s civil rights movement. A few months earlier, King and his followers had been sicked on by police dogs and fire hoses. In protests in Birmingham, Alabama, they were all arrested. It was Detroit that served as the bank for the civil rights movement. United Auto Workers' money went down to Birmingham to get King and his followers out of jail. It was Reverend Franklin who invited King up to Detroit that summer on June 23rd to lead a rally down Woodward Avenue in a speech at Cobo Hall. 100,000 people came to the rally. Berry Gordy, another major figure in my book, recorded the speech for Motown Records. And it was in Detroit, 2 months before Washington, that King uttered the first variation of I Have a Dream. It got lost to history because of what happened in Washington 2 months later. And so did Berry Gordy's record, because his record came out on August 28th.
A little late.
The day after the Washington speech, so yes.
Exactly right. Along those lines, Mayor Jerome Kavanaugh and Police Chief George Edwards, when they came north from the Alabama situation, they said that you will not get sicked on by fire hoses here nor dogs. They were not Bull Connor. It was a very different environment.
It really was. And Jerome Kavanaugh had been elected mayor in 1961 as a reform mayor. With the first significant African-American vote after a reaction against some police incidents in 59 and 60. He persuaded a man named George Edwards to become his police commissioner. Edwards stepped down from the Michigan Supreme Court to take that job, and he said he did it with one purpose in mind, to try to improve race relations in Detroit, which had a very difficult history. They were making some successes. It was Edwards who greeted King at the airport and said, as you said, you'll find no police dogs sicking you here. They marched arm in arm with King. And things looked promising. But I always consider race the American dilemma. It is today in many ways, it was then. And only a month after this speech, something else happened.
St. Cynthia.
Yes.
Am I jumping ahead here a little bit, of course? But July 5th, 1963, St. Cynthia, she was not exactly a saint.
No,
you explain that.
St. Cynthia was a 6'1" prostitute, John R. in Detroit. And one evening, she, under questionable circumstances, was shot in the back by a Detroit police officer. This is 50 years ago, you know, and it created the same difficulties that Ferguson and Cleveland and everything else of the last year has created in America, where the black community felt that they were being, that police were shooting at them with unwarranted, where the police felt they were under siege. And much of the hard work that Mayor Kavanaugh and Commissioner Edwards had put in the previous 2 years sort of started collapsing at that point on the way towards what would happen after my book is over, which is 1967.
Along those lines, in 62, Detroit bids for the Olympics. And this is, when I ever tell this story to people, because Fred Gerard wrote about this in the Detroit News when I was there in 98, I think it was. Uh-huh. And I was fascinated by this, and you did a much deeper job. You did drill very deeply in this one to find out the exact circumstances behind this. Detroit actually won the United States bid to become the Olympic host for 1968, 1 year after the riots would happen, of course. Tell us how close they were, why it failed, and what it could have done for
yes.
Detroit.
Well, Detroit, I didn't know any of this before I started researching the book. But as it turned out, Detroit had been very much an important part of the Olympic movement for quite a while and had been the American nominee for hosting Olympics 3 times before that. But they thought finally they would win it for the 1968 Olympics. And the decision was made right in the middle of my book in 1963. Two members of the International Olympic Committee were from Detroit, including Avery Brundage, who was the president of the IOC, was born in Detroit. They had Governor George Romney and Jerome Kavanaugh, a Republican and Democrat, working together with the entire business community in a very concerted effort that had both national and international conflicts. In terms of the United States, it was one of the first iterations of the Rust Belt versus the Sun Belt. Los Angeles looked condescendingly toward Detroit.
No, stop right there. I can't believe that.
And did everything they could to undermine Detroit's bid, including sending letters to other countries and trying to get, at the last minute, get the bid themselves. Detroit overcame that. Then went to Baden-Baden, West Germany, where they were the favorites. Most of the international press corps thought Detroit would get the nomination, I mean the bid. And a couple of things happened. One was internal, and I don't think it had as much impact as sometimes some people attributed to it. But at that time, the Detroit City Council voted 7-2 against an open housing measure, mm-hmm. and several African-American leaders in Detroit were thinking, well, if they can't even respect individual human rights in Detroit, why should they get the Olympic movement and its human rights for the world? So they wrote some letters criticizing Detroit. That certainly was interesting and sociologically important, but the world was changing so much in 1963 in terms of the Cold War, of the rise of South America and Africa and Asian countries into the Olympic movement, that Detroit really, in the United States, didn't have a shot at that moment, and it went to Mexico City instead, the first non-European or American city to get the Olympics. Or I should say United States, not American. But in any case, it's interesting counterfactual history to think about what if.
You and know, what if? What did the riots in 67?
You know, possibly the leaders in Detroit would have been more sensitive to what was bubbling up and taken steps that might have alleviated some of the situations that led to the riots of 1967. We don't know. We don't know whether it would have been an economic boon for Detroit or not, mm-hmm. because some cities have success from the Olympics, and others like Montreal and Athens, it's a disaster economically, and the Olympic sites become sort of quick ruins or torn down after a while. They would have built a stadium almost as big as the Big House mm-hmm. out in the state fairgrounds to be the main stadium for that. Would that have prevented the Lions from going to wherever they went for those 25 years or whatever?
A little longer, but yeah, go ahead, yeah. Yes.
and also, you know, 1968 was this year of black power, where there was a movement to boycott the Olympics, mm-hmm. Where Tommy Smith and John Carlos raised their fists in protest of American racism. And if that had happened in Detroit, one of the central American cities dealing with African American life, it could have had a whole deeper resonance to it. So there are all these interesting what ifs, and you never know.
Never know, but it is interesting. And when you tell people that, they're stunned to hear that Detroit was a serious contender for the Olympics in 1968.
Yes.
But that's how high Detroit was.
It was regarded, yeah, it thought of itself as an international city.
And largely was. The Wayne State Report, this is one of the big shockers in your book that really took me back. Wayne State saw the problems long before everyone else seemed to have.
Well, yes, at least they articulated the problem. Some others might have seen it, but Wayne State, two sociologists there, came out with a study in the late spring of 1963, essentially predicting everything that would follow. That Detroit would depopulate by 500,000 people by the end of that decade, and that trend would continue for the foreseeable future for reasons of the over-reliance on one industry, because of the racial tensions in Detroit, because of the unwitting negative consequences of urban renewal. Some of the factors were common to all cities. Detroit was just kind of an exaggeration of them all. So that when Eastland and Northland and Westland and Southland all developed this sort of noose around the downtown area, mm-hmm. The freeways made it easier for people to leave the city. A lot of reasons for that, the love of the new, you know, of suburbia, escaping racial tensions, better schools, whatever, but that all was accelerated during that period. And the sociologists at Wayne State saw it. And I think that a lot of the leaders in Detroit were blinded by their own success at that
point. Sounds about right. They're ahead of the game, of course. The book, by the way, is very serious in many ways, deep research, wistful in many places, as you point out, also heartbreaking. But it actually is, I hate to tell you, a ton of fun along the way. One of the reasons is Berry Gordy Jr. is a classic character, a force of nature. Please tell us a bit about him and the fact that he was, in fact, considered a square in high school. And one of his favorite songs is Revenge for Being a Square, which I, of course, take to
well,
heart.
Well, during that period, African-Americans would go to the Greystoke Ballroom once a week. They were allowed to dance there. And Berry Gordy couldn't dance. He had this policy of 2 out of 10. He'd ask 10 girls to dance and 2 might say yes. And so his later revenge was the song that some of you might remember, Do You Love Me Now That I Can Dance?
We've all known that song forever. The story behind it is actually entirely real, a little bitter.
Yes.
The guy who created Motown.
So Berry Gordy still alive. I went out to Los Angeles. You know, Motown started in Detroit in 1959 with an $800 loan that Berry Gordy got from his family, 8 siblings and his parents. They had sort of their own little family bank. They'd all put money into it every month and then vote on where it would go. And Berry, sort of the second youngest, not a very good student, kind of a messed up kid, but loved jazz and music. He convinced them that he was going to start this record company, and they gave him the $800. 1959, by 1971, it was gone. It moved to Los Angeles.
With the Jacksons and everybody else.
And all of that. So I went out to L.A., where he still lives, in Bel Air, on the highest hill in a mansion. I interviewed him in his pool house, which was bigger than most regular houses. It was like 80 degrees out, but it was January, so he was wearing a heavy wool cap and sweater and ordered lunch for us and talked for several hours. It was an unforgettable experience. And he told me, you know, some stories that he hadn't told before and some that were more common. Everybody called Berry Gordy Chairman. Chairman Gordy, that's the way others at Motown referred to it. And I said, well, how did that happen? And he said, you know, actually it had nothing to do with Motown. When I was a little kid, there were rats in our house. And my dad would be running around chasing rats and killing them. And I was mortally afraid of rats, so I would get on a chair. And my sisters would call me the little chairman. But he also told the stories of how he started composing songs. He played the piano. He wasn't a great musician. And he had a very simplistic way of denoting songs, sort of like, you know, those little xylophones that would have numbers on them? Well, he would think about notes that way, number them 1, 2, 3, 4. And he worked on the assembly line, the Lincoln Mercury assembly line. And he was so good, or he decided to become so proficient at his role on the assembly line, dealing with, I don't know, fastening seats or something, that he would do it in 30 seconds, and then he'd have 4.5 minutes before the next car would come along. And during those 4.5 minutes, he'd compose songs. And he started thinking about an assembly line as a means of this unfinished product coming in, you know, just chrome and steel and rubber, and this beautiful Detroit auto coming out on the other end. And in some sense, he fashioned Motown out of that, bringing this raw material, raw talent into Motown and having something polished come out on the other end.
It's a wonderful story. I love that part, of course. In some ways, and you make the point that Motown in some ways does mirror the rise and fall of Detroit, that what made it great also marked its downfall. The military sort of approach that Gordy had?
Well, I think that I don't, you know, my feeling about that is that I wanted to write about early Motown, so 62 and 63, because generally you find that some very successful artists, and just a lot of industries as well, and politicians, the early years have this sort of sense of freedom and liberation and freshness that falls apart through jealousies, through ambition, money, drugs. All of these things would come later. Mm-hmm. And early Motown was sort of beautifully innocent in a way. Not completely innocent, but much more natural and a community, a sensibility, which would diminish over time as it became more successful. And that happens in life.
In the same way you've denoted Detroit on the way up, Berry Gordy Jr., of course,
yes.
Hank the Deuce, many others, Walter Reuther, and your other books. I'm going to switch gears here, unless you have more to add about the current one. I got to get to a few of these. The Bill Clinton book, of course, First in His Class, came out in 94. Won the Pulitzer, you said the articles led up to the Pulitzer Prize, so I've heard recently. Oh, and by the way, Doug Stanton, where are you? I was not the worst coach in school history, I was the worst player in school history, all right? That's a very important part of pride with me, and let's get that right.
Yeah, so, and we can all identify with your marital spat.
There you go, yes.
In different ways.
Doug's, not mine.
So, right.
My wife is right up there, there we go.
Marital teasing.
There we go. First in His Class, of course, the Bill Clinton himself, it was a great seller, of course, critically acclaimed. However, the Commander-in-Chief did not like it so much. Explain how you figured that out.
Well, when the book came out, it's not hagiography, it's not an attack, it's an effort to be honest about this incredibly talented and flawed human being and politician. So Clinton loved half the book and would read it to his staff. And he would hate half the book and, you know, complain to his staff. But then publicly, he'd say he didn't read it. He hadn't read it. And so, of course, I knew he had, but the proof came in a really bizarre way. You remember Kenneth Starr and his investigation of Clinton over the Lewinsky scandal? Well, Starr issued this long report, and it had an addendum that listed all of the books in the room behind the Oval Office where he fooled around with Monica Lewinsky. As if that's anybody's, you know. But in any case, the list of books included First in His Class, my book, with annotations by BC and HRC, meaning they both had read it, and they both were marking down parts of it. So,
but not apparently at that moment, no, but anyway.
So Clinton, who I had interviewed many, many times when I was, before I started the book in 92 during the campaign, wouldn't talk to me after the book came out. And that persisted for a couple of years. And then 2 years later, as president, he came to the convention of the newspaper editors in Washington, where the president traditionally gives the speech every other year. And he was hobbling on crutches. He'd just fallen off the front stoop of Greg Norman, the golfer's house down in Florida. So he comes hobbling in, and I'm at the dais too because I'd won their award that year. And we were to meet for the first time since my book came out. He gave his speech. I was on the other side, so we hadn't met yet. And then, of course, Clinton can't go to any crowd without working the rope line. So to get the rope line, he had to walk by me. And I was kind of tongue-tied. I hadn't spoken to him in a couple of years, and I didn't know what to say. And Clinton always knows what to say. And he shook my hand and said, "Hi, David, congratulations on your award. Nice tie." So my wife and my dad are in the audience, and I whispered out to them, "He said nice tie." So Clinton comes around. He's, you know, I don't know, he's got his arm around my wife, but he's talking to her really, you know. And then he's talking to my dad about Greg Norman and falling off the stoop. And my father's first words to him were, "Nice tie, Mr. President." I don't know why he said it. But, and then, so 2 months later, I was in New York City starting research on another book, the Lombardi book. And I went out to a dinner, and George Stephanopoulos was another person at the dinner. Stephanopoulos had been one of Clinton's top aides. And we were talking about how intelligent, exhausting, exhilarating, frustrating, all of the different adjectives you can use about Bill Clinton. And Stephanopoulos said, "Well, Dave, did he ever talk to you after your book came out?" And I said, "No, not really. All he ever said was, when we met, he said, nice tie." And so, this is an adult crowd. So Stephanopoulos said, "Well, you know what nice tie means in Clinton's private lexicon?" I said, "No." He said, "Well, it means fuck you." So my father, who loved Bill Clinton, unwittingly responded in kind.
Some things are poetic justice, I guess.
And I can't tell you how many Washington Press White House correspondents came up to me afterwards and said, "I always thought he really liked my tie."
Incredibly, we are getting near the end. But before we move on to a brief video here, I would like to point out that among Doug and Ann Stanton, David Marinus, the Pulitzer Prize winner, of course, and myself, I am the only one wearing a tie. Can I? If you tell me nice tie, I'm now wise to you. The current campaign, before we move on to the video, sure. We cannot let you go without some observations thereof.
What
nice
do you
tie.
Think? I think that this is the culmination of a deterioration of American politics that's been going on for quite a while. It's kind of difficult for me to cover it as someone searching for facts and the truth. It's been difficult for a lot of serious reporters. And just one of many aspects of it is that There seems to be a complete disregard for the truth. So you can imagine what I'm thinking deeper than that. usually I come back to the Washington Post and do major profiles of candidates. I'd already written about Hillary enough that I didn't feel I wanted necessarily to do that again. And the other person I couldn't write about.
There it is.
Yep.
On that note, we're going to tie it back to the book in question, of course.
Now, are we going to take some questions or no?
We're going to do that or the video. We want to do questions first?
Yeah, I think so.
Let's do that,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah.
We've got a good chunk of time for questions here. Do not waste your chance. We've got the man right here in the front. We've got a microphone running around here somewhere.
Nice socks.
Nice socks, yeah. Wait, what does that mean exactly?
That means you love me.
His are a lot cooler than mine, so I know you're talking about his. I'm just glad I'm wearing them today. That's always a success. So, sir, in the front, Casey, I believe.
I'll repeat your question.
When Detroit failed, went down the path of failure, where was the void in leadership? Was it the auto industry politically, or what happened?
When Detroit failed, where was the void in leadership? It was everywhere. The auto industry had, by then, essentially abandoned Detroit, not just physically, moving out of the city and around the country and the world, which perhaps in some ways was inevitable, but more importantly, abandoning Detroit psychologically and emotionally, and not realizing that it was the living heartbeat of what they were. And so, after my book came out, when I was talking to some executives at the big three, they acknowledged that, and realized the huge mistake that they made in that decision. Ford Motor Company, which is the one I write about the most, I mean, their whole, even though they brought thousands and thousands of workers to Detroit over a long period of time, Henry Ford, the founder, a man of perhaps great talents in terms of marketing and conceiving an automobile, was not just a horrible anti-Semite, but also hated cities. And so, many of you have probably visited Greenfield Village. It's an evocation of a mythological rural pastoral America. And it has, that's the America that Henry Ford wanted, not the teeming cities of America. And so Ford Motor Company always had sort of this hostility towards the cities because of the founder. Then there were the difficulties that Detroit had racially, started going all the way back to World War II when there was a major race riot in the city in 1943, and that had never been resolved. And then the urban renewal with its ripple effects through the city, spurring white flight. So I think there's blame to go all around. One of the points I wanted to make in the book is that certainly the later effects of the pension problems in Detroit, of the racial tensions from 67, you can argue those one way or another, but the structural problems were already there. And they were evident in 1963 before all of that. So I think that it was a whole series of missteps, of lack of leadership that led to this long decline, which only right now is turning around.
Adding two more to that, based on your book, of course, Henry the Ford.
Henry the
Nice socks. Henry Ford was anti-city. I was surprised to learn that Henry Ford II,
yeah.
Hank the Deuce, was also anti-Detroit, surprisingly.
Well, in some way, he wasn't so much anti-Detroit as that Ford, the Deuce was more, he became bored by Detroit. He became a jet setter. And as a matter of fact, one of the stories in my book is about the creation of the Mustang. And my wife and I went down to Duke University, which has the largest archive marketing and advertising archive in the world. It includes all of the papers of the J. Walter Thompson Advertising Agency, the largest advertising agency in the world, and 10% of J. Walter Thompson's business in 1963 was Ford Motor Company. So they were in charge of marketing the Mustang. And they had a private whole floor of the Buell Building in downtown Detroit where their ad men were figuring it out. And the papers at Duke told us two things. One is that the first name for the Mustang was going to be the Torino, which became a later Ford car. Here's to get to your point. The reason it wasn't called the Torino is because at that time, Henry Ford II, the Deuce, was having an affair with an Italian jet setter. And they thought it might not be too wise to have it named after an Italian car. And to bring that all the way around to the title of my book, and or why my the inspiration for my book, the first advertising motto for that Mustang or Torino in 1963 was Torino imported from Detroit, which is the same motto that Chrysler used in the ad that got me to start this book.
What comes around goes around. More questions.
Up here. We have a question up here. Up
Sir?
Here?
Oh,
up
yes.
High.
Oh, thank you.
Sorry.
I wanted to ask then, in the wake of everything that's happened bad in Detroit, about a year ago, my daughter, after I told her about being in school down there in 67, my daughter took me around Detroit now.
Yes.
And her friends who are moving there and getting great house prices.
Absolutely.
And we go to Heidelberg and Slows and the Kahlo exhibit and all that stuff. Is that true?
Yeah,
I mean, is it going as well as it seems to be going, or is that
just
another urban legend there?
You're asking us to rat out your daughter? Is that
Yeah. Was it my daughter?
You know, I write in the book that is only half jokingly that when my wife and I first got there 4.5 years ago, and we'd go over from one side of Woodward Avenue across the street to the Reuther Library, I felt I could sit down in the middle of Woodward Avenue and read War and Peace and not get hit by a car. That has changed remarkably. And yes, part of it is true. Young people are moving into Detroit, foodies, techies, entrepreneurs. It's a great place for millennials to go because the housing is cheap. There's a lot of creative energy building up among them. And I tell young people, go to Detroit. There's a certain freedom there now that was not unlike what it was in the early 60s. You can experiment and do things, sort of like early Motown. But you know, as a lifelong journalist, I try never to be cynical, but always skeptical. So there are parts of this story that are true. The population is increasing for the first time in decades. Yes, young people are moving in. Yes, Mayor Duggan seems to have a very precise understanding of his city and what needs to be done on a really basic level of street lights and tearing down abandoned houses and building up different parts of the city. A lot of money is going into downtown. There are new restaurants coming in almost every week. But Detroit is a vast geographic area. It's 57 square miles. And there are miles and miles of it that are desolate still. And there's a lot of people there who are not part of the recovery. And I think Detroit understands this time that to have a real recovery, it has to be for all the people. The working people who helped build Detroit can't be left behind with all of this gentrification. It's not an easy problem. And the most difficult problem of all, of course, is the one that every city in America faces, which has to do with public education. Because for all of these young people who are moving into Detroit, one can assume that they'll get married, they'll have kids, and then what do? And that's the test of the future for Detroit.
Let's see here. Sir, in the front.
In your book, you talk about four themes that ran through automotive music and so forth.
Yes.
In light of Grant's question, we see a lot of success in Detroit now, or emerging success. Is that a result of enduring qualities along those same four lines?
Um, I don't think so, honestly. I mean, I think that the labor movement is certainly not what it was. And I mean, Michigan is now a right-to-work state. I mean, there's a vast difference both in the public perceptions of unions and in the strength of unions. That will never come back. I think that race relations are still, you know, a dilemma in Detroit and a lot of other places. Motown is gone. The music is still there in Detroit. And when people ask me, what can Detroit do, this morning I went to this great school here up, what Jan was talking about, you know, the tech school, where they were really had the arts there. You know, it wasn't just, you know, shop. It was writers and documentarians, and all the arts would seem to be flourishing at that school. And I think that's incredibly important for young people. And I think Detroit schools should emphasize what their traditions are, which one of them is great music. You know, so the more, when I was doing this book, the one common thread of all of the musicians I interviewed was they remembered their public high school music teachers. You know, that has to come back in some ways, but the music is still lives. And the car industry is coming back. It will never be the same, but it understands now that it can't abandon Detroit, and there's more of a commitment to it. And the Ford Foundation, which is separate from Ford Motor Company but still grew out of it, was instrumental in the grand bargain that helped save Detroit, as were some of the other auto industries, parts of it. So I think it will be different, and it should be different. I think that for Detroit to flourish anew, it has to rebuild itself in a different way and more diversified.
One striking thing, by the way, about Motown, when I taught high school back in Ann Arbor, those students, our kids and so on, they listen to your music. We did not listen to my parents' music, all right? That's a fundamentally different thing that's happened over the generations.
Oh, sure, I'm a 60s guy. Was I listening to the music of 1910, you know? I couldn't even tell you what it was. But people still listen to the Beatles
lasted.
And Motown. And
it has endured.
Yeah.
And by the way, Eminem, a little fun side fact, he's got a place on Torch Lake, not too far from here, right across the lake from my parents. Took the boat across the lake. I saw a very nice house, and I thought, oh, that's got to be his. And then I realized that's his servant's house. And the larger castle to the right was, in fact, his house with 9 jet skis in front of it, because what can you possibly do with 8, right? I mean, why even bother at that point? So if you want to stalk Eminem, that's how you do it. So we got a question
here.
Up here.
We have a question up here. Thank you.
Yeah, when you write about
Detroit,
Up here, sorry. Up here in the balcony.
Oh, okay.
Yes,
and then,
you.
And then,
I'm on. Yes, you are on. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I absolutely loved the book.
Thank you.
And I think that your daughter is spot on, because I sat there thinking, I want that emotion. I want a bus tour. I want to see these places. I want pictures and music and really be fully immersed in it. And I think that'd be such a great idea. And I also want you to know, in 2011, I worked for JWT.
Uh-huh.
And we watched that Chrysler commercial at the Super Bowl after working on Ford's Super Bowl ad, and our jaws dropped.
Yeah.
That was amazing.
Yeah.
But that's what I thought about, was just that emotion that you evoke is so great.
Thank you. And I actually have 8 videos, but because of the screen here, it would have been too weird to have it come up and down 8 times. So we're going to show one more, which will blow you away at the end.
It's a lot of emotion for you there at the end.
Yeah.
Here in the front, sir.
When you write about Detroit, did you consider the fact that it has 50-plus suburbs that are balkanization of Detroit, Metro Detroit? When people think of Detroit, I think of all of that, not just the inner city. And the second question is, would the downfall also be related to selling off of its streetcars and putting that people mover in?
My wife and I rode that people mover, and it didn't go anywhere.
Yes.
Except to this weird casino. I think that one of the factors in Detroit's difficulties was a lack of good mass transit, which every other big city in America, except LA, has. And the reasons why LA and Detroit don't have it are the same. a conspiracy by the either rubber companies or the car manufacturers to keep mass transit away. I think that was very much a problem in Detroit. I didn't do deep research on the people mover because it happened much after the period of my book, but I have talked to several people both in Washington, D.C., who were in the transportation department then, and people in Detroit. And it was a lot of missed signals that happened and unfortunate events that led to a people mover that didn't go anywhere and didn't move any people. I mean, it was empty the day I was on it. I forgot your, the other question was about, sure. I mean, I write about Dearborn a lot of the suburbs are in the book, Grosse Pointe, Dearborn, Birmingham, places where the executives lived that would come into Detroit or where the auto, you know, in Dearborn was the Ford Motor Company. I, in many ways, I include the whole area as Detroit, yeah.
By the way, a little fun fact also, at the Detroit News in the late 90s, we used to call the people mover the person mover.
Yeah, that's about it.
That's about all I could really
okay.
We'll take two more questions.
Okay, sure.
Sounds good.
There's one
Where
up here.
Well, 1 second, your microphone's coming right now.
Would you comment on your writing process? How you pull all this detail together?
I talk about, in a larger sense, the four legs of the table that I use. And the first leg is go there, wherever there is, so I can feel the culture and sociology of the place. So for my my book on Vince Lombardi, it meant turning to my wife and uttering the immortal loving words, "How would you like to move to Green Bay for the winter?" To which she responded, "Brr." But we did, and it made all the difference in the sensibility that I could get from this one company town in a very cold place. So that's the first leg. The second leg is archival materials, because contemporaneous letters and documents are invaluable in getting the reality of something that interviews can't always capture because of people's faulty memories. The third leg is interviews, so I talk to hundreds of people for my books. And the key ones I go back to again and again, because the more I know, the more someone is likely to remember. First interview is often useless except for setting a tone and a relationship. And the fourth leg I talk about is kind of metaphysical, which is look for what's not there. There's always a conventional wisdom and mythology about something, and to try to get past that is the fourth part of it. In terms of pure writing, I'm really lucky because I'm completely incompetent at everything else in life. So that I'm not as distracted. And I love to write. So I don't have writer's block very often. And when I do, it's because I haven't done the research. I also believe that organization is sort of boring, but incredibly important. And so many writers, nonfiction writers, have an overload of information and it becomes oppressive. And so every hour that I spend organizing that and figuring it out saves 3 hours of writing. I tend to write in the morning, or I did until I got too old. Now I sleep a little late. I mean, sometimes old people get up earlier. I tend to sleep a little later. But in any case, my most productive hours are usually in the morning and late at night. In the middle of the day, I'm kind of useless and do other things. I don't set a daily goal of how much I'm going to write, because every day is different and my mood is different. So I try to set weekly goals. And some days I'll write 50 words, and some days, one time for the Lombardi book, the climatic chapter in the football part of the book, it's not really a football book, but the Packers were a great football team, and there was a game called the Ice Bowl, which was played in 17 degree minus weather, which is why we had to move to Green Bay so I could experience that. But I was so ready for that climatic game, which the Packers won in the last second, that I started it at 6 in the morning and I finished it at midnight, 12,000 words, because I was just ready for it.
Wow. Wow, I feel bad. Okay. Thank you for that bit of motivation there, David.
He's the motivational speaker.
Yeah, it's not working at night. We've got time for one more question here. Ma'am.
Your characterization of Walter Reuther revealed him to me, at least, to be a remarkable human being.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if you see a need for one or more Walter Reuthers today and what you would predict.
I think the world could always use more Walter Reuthers. You know, he wasn't a perfect human being, but he was, he had a lot of foresight. He could see things that were coming. He could see the technological changes that would affect the working class in America. He saw what was going to happen in terms of foreign smaller cars and tried to urge the big three to consider building smaller cars. And of course, he was very progressive on civil rights at a period where he was pretty far out in front of the rank and file of his own union, many of whom later became the Reagan Democrats in Macomb County and probably voted for Trump this primary. I think Walter Reuther is one of the great underappreciated characters in 20th century American's history. He was vital to both helping bring the working class into the middle class in America. I think the UAW was as responsible for that as any other union. And for trying to, you know, he wrote a lot about trying to bring dignity to the lives of the working class, not just the dignity of having the job, but of what else they could do with their lives when they weren't working. He was an idealist, but a pragmatic guy who had been beat up by the Ford goons when he first started organizing in the 30s. He had George Romney, the governor, when he was running American Motors, called Reuther the most dangerous man in Detroit, most dangerous man in America. But in fact, they got along pretty well once they were both dealing with each other and helped bring labor peace to Detroit in the early 1950s. I don't see anybody in the labor movement now that's comparable to Reuther, but the labor movement isn't comparable in any way. I just think there's so much ideological noise in America today that it's really hard for any figure to sort of have that level of esteem that some people did in that period. There's certainly there was some hatred of Reuther among executives and people who didn't like labor. But Henry Ford II said he admired Reuther greatly.
That's a lot. We're going to close up here shortly. A few final words from yours truly, and then, of course, David, and then a video, and then David will close that out as well. But I want you guys to know that about a year ago, I pitched Ann and Doug Stanton, great friends of my wife's and mine, about David Marinus, trying to urge him to come here. I pitched him as well. And I sold him on Traverse City. That was always the key. And that seems to have worked out quite well once again. I can tell you that in my business, the guys at the top, and I've had a chance to work with a number of them, they're all hardworking, they're all smart. You cannot be stupid and lazy and luck your way into a Pulitzer Prize. It does not happen that way. But they're all hardworking, smart, and either really cool or real jerks. Very rarely in the middle. And you've met tonight one of my all-time favorite, clearly a great guy, on top of being a great journalist. And thank you tonight for coming. Thank you.
Something that touched my heart, and it began this way. I was born by the river. just like the river. I've been running ever since. He said it's been a long time coming, but I know my change is gonna come. To my